Well, it's been a beautiful weekend, right? And so we could look at it and say, what a better way to end the weekend. However, Sunday isn't the last day of the week, is it? It's the first day of the week, so maybe we can say, what a beautiful way to begin the week. And we begin here in worship. And I'm glad to see you this morning. Before we do begin worship, just a reminder that Vim Week is coming up on July 11th to the 15th, volunteers in mission, and you can sign up out on the connections table to volunteer for that week, or if you have a project that you would like us to consider, you can sign up out there as well. But everything for Vim is out there. The other thing I want to say is that it's been a long time coming, and maybe we could have done it months ago, I don't know, but next Sunday, we're going to begin passing the offering plates again. And we're going to need some people to usher. So if you would like to participate as ushers, you can talk to John Lucas and he'll get you worked out. And then if you've never done it before, he'll tell you how we take up the offerings here. So starting next week, we'll be passing the plates again. And I just want to welcome back Tom and Lucy. They were away for a week at a music convention and learning new tricks to the craft of worship leading and learning new music and ways that they can enhance their gifts that are already fantastic, but to use those gifts and new ideas to make our worship even that more vital. So welcome back, guys.
Thank you.
And now, let us begin worship. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Please stand if you are able and join me in the call to worship, which is choral this morning. Change my heart, O God. In the garden, number 314. Let us pray the prayer of the day in unison, followed by a moment of silent prayer. Lord, we give thanks for fellowship and family. We pray that you will strengthen us, restore us, inspire us with your love, and fill us with your peace, that we may share your good news with all the earth. Amen. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. God's word gives us the assurance that he hears our prayers. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, next week during this time period, we'll be passing the offering plates. Jesus tells his disciples, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. Let us take this time to consider all the ways that we may be of service to others and our God. let us pray together the prayer of dedication. Gracious God, I dedicate these gifts to your kingdom work and my life to you as a living sacrifice, bringing all my actions under the atoning blood of Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, come and fill your temple. Amen.
You may be seated, and as we prepare to sing our prayer hymn this morning, this is a song we did several times during the pandemic, and hopefully it's familiar to you, but will you join me in singing In Need? In need of grace, in need of love, in need of mercy raining down from high above, in need of strength, in need of peace, in need of things that only you can give. In need of Christ, the perfect Lamb, my refuge strong, the great I am. This is my song, my humble plea. I am your child, I am in. Let's sing that again. In need of grace, in need of love, in need of mercy raining down from high above, in need of strength, in need of peace, in need of things that only you can give to me. In need of Christ, the perfect Lamb, my refuge strong, the great I am. This is my song, my humble plea. I am your child, I am in need, I am your child, I am in need. Almighty God, we do need you, not just this morning and not just occasionally, but Lord, we need you every day, we need you every hour. Lord, as we look around at our world and we read the headlines, we see the things happening, we know we are in need. And Lord, it is great to know that when we call upon your name, if we are faithful, if we will humbly turn our face to you, you are faithful to hear our prayers. And so, Lord, in our times of trial and in our times of temptation, in our times of grief and in pain, in times when we need healing, Lord, we call upon you, for we are in need. Lord, I pray this morning that you would hear each prayer. We're going to take a little time and allow people to speak from their heart. And Lord, if there are those here today who just don't have the words to describe how they're feeling, and Lord, may your Holy Spirit take those feelings and then translate them into words into your ear. So hear your children, Lord, all of us who are in need. Lord, you are our grace, our love, and our mercy. And we need all of those things. You are our strength, our peace. You are the Christ, the perfect Lamb. You are a refuge that is strong. And so, Lord, this morning we sing our thanks to you in our need. And Lord, even when we're in those dark places, may we see the positive, like stars in the night sky lighting up all around us. Lord, we pray that next week we might come back and just give testimony to all the answered prayers that you have heard today and will work out in the next week. Lord, all of this we give thanks to Jesus, the one who meets every need. Amen.
Let us pray the prayer of illumination in unison. Dear Lord, enlighten us as we seek to know you through your word. Lead us by the light of your glory that our hearts may be opened, that we can receive every word you speak to us this day. Amen. The New Testament reading, Mark 4, verses 1 through 10. Again, he began to teach beside the sea. Such a very large crowd gathered around him that he got into a boat on the sea and sat there while the whole crowd was beside the sea on the land. He began to teach them many things in parables, and in his teaching, he said to them, "Listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seed fell on the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Other seed fell on rocky ground where it did not have much soil, and it sprang up quickly, since it had no depth of soil. And when the sun rose, it was scorched, and since it had no root, it withered away. Other seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no grain. Other seed fell into good soil and brought forth grain, growing up and increasing and yielding 30 and 60 and 100-fold. And he said, "Let anyone with ears to hear listen." When he was alone, those who were around him, along with the 12, asked him about the parables. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Jesus said to them, "Do you not understand this parable? Then how will you understand all the parables? The sower sows the word. These are the ones on the path where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan immediately comes and takes away the word that is sown in them. And these are the ones sown on rocky ground. When they hear the word, they immediately receive it with joy, but they have no root and endure only for a while. Then, when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately they fall away. And others are those sown among the thorns, but those are the ones who hear the word. But the cares of the world and the lure of wealth and the desire for other things comes in and chokes the word, and it yields nothing. And these are the ones sown on good soil. They hear the word and accept it and bear fruit 30 and 60 and 100-fold. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Last week I was pulling some weeds around the parsonage, and I reached down to grab a hold of this weed, and when I pulled, the top just came off of it. I thought, oh, that's a pretty stiff one. So I reached down a little farther and got a hold of it, and I'm starting to pull on this thing, and it wouldn't budge. I mean, it was really down there. I could have tied my car up to it with a chain, and I don't think it would have come out. And it made me think, wow, these roots are really deep. And I was amazed by it. But then I started thinking about all the other ones I was pulling and how short their roots were. Of course, that all reminded me of the parable of the soils, which we just read. This parable is often called the parable of the seeds or the parable of the sower. But the biblical title is the parable of the soils because it doesn't really have anything to do with the sower, the person, the evangelist. And it's not really about the seed or the word of God, the gospel message, but rather this parable is about soil, the receptiveness of an individual person to accept the gospel message from the preaching of the word. So it's about the soil of a person's heart. Now, last year, around this time, I preached on this parable also. And you might recall I separated the church up into different quadrants. You were each a different kind of soil. And we had some birds fly in and scoop it out. And I thought, well, I can't do that again. So I thought, what if we applied this parable more broadly? What if we applied the parable not to an individual, but to the church? And so this morning, I want to look at this, at the soil of the church. You know, somewhere along the line, people, they come in contact with the gospel and they receive the seed of the message. For some, it's through a worship service. Others, a televangelist or a radio preacher. For others, they receive the seed of the gospel through music or through a biblical tract or through a friend. Doesn't matter, the gospel has been created to be spread, and it does in many ways. It's like a wildflower. It produces all this seed, and the wind comes and blows the seed to another field. Or maybe a seed hitches a ride on an animal, or a bird carries it off somewhere else, or the rain comes down and washes it away to another place. Gospel has many ways of getting spread, and one of these seeds takes hold in the heart of men and women and children all over the world. It gets in there, it starts to grow, but then what? What happens to it after that? Well, the seed takes on life. It sprouts, and you have a new creation or a new plant, but the seed needs a garden to plant itself in. And so this new seed, this new plant goes out looking for a garden, a church to settle into. And that's what I want to examine this morning, is how fertile is the soil or the garden, the church in which these seeds fall into. You know, I'll tell you again, I will not apologize, but you'll hear me. I love our camping program, and the reason I've been in it for so long is, like I've said, there's nothing we do as a church or a conference that makes disciples of Jesus Christ like our camping program. And I've seen these kids come in into our camp for a week, and they're this soil. And it's like they're in a nursery, and throughout the week, we nourish them, and we take care of them, and we warm them, and you can see them germinating through the week. And by the end of the week, with some of them, you'll see them, they'll sprout roots of faith. Or the roots of faith that were there become longer. And then we send them back to their gardens to be planted. The problem is, though, is that I've seen too many of these kids go back wanting to get involved in their church with ideas. They want to do things, and they're told, no, we don't do that here, or you're too young. And these plants wither and die because the soil of the garden that we send them back to isn't always good. In Mark, Jesus said some of the seed fell on weedy soil. These are people who hear the word, but they get choked out by the things of life. There are some churches whose soil is filled with weed seed. People come into the church and they sit down in a pew. They start to settle in, and then this weed snuggles right up against them. and starts whispering in their ear, "Did you hear about so-and-so?" And then in the other ear, "Can you believe our pastor said this last week?" You see, the old bindweed of gossip gets its grips on them and won't let go. And there are those pessimists who will tell these new seeds all the things they tried to do and failed. And they don't think anything will ever work. They're not sure we'll ever get anything done. So along with the bindweed of gossip comes this negativity and this worry and this sorrow. And they surround this new plant on all sides. And then there's the thorns who shoot down anything that's not part of their agenda or, you know, they're not involved in. And this new sprout has come into a church and it's set down. But all the negativity of the weeds grab it and crowd it out, holding it down, never letting it see the actual sun, never allowing it to mature. And so it gets crushed and it just disappears out of the church garden, never to be seen again. Another type of church soil is rocky soil. This is soil that looks good, but just under the surface of that dirt are these huge rocks. New believers come into the church and immediately say, "This looks like a place for me. It's fun and appears to be alive." For me, the rocky soil church is the one that has all the bells and whistles and looks great. It's got, you know, the lights and the fog machines. It's got the guitars. It's got the praise team. It's got the dancers. It's got all of these things going on, but that's as far as it goes. There's nothing deeper to sink into. There's no small groups. There's no Bible studies. It's all about the experience of that Sunday morning, but there's nothing throughout the week to continue to grow in. And so the people, when their faith gets tested, they fall away because there's no substance to what they're doing. There's just the experience, and the experience isn't enough to carry them. So they get uprooted. A third type of soil Jesus spoke of is the hard soil. Soil on which the seed is scattered, but it can't find a place to get its roots into the actual dirt. And this can be the church that is cold and uninviting. New people come in and no one speaks to them. And if they do, it's to tell them, "Hey, you're in my seat." This is, you know, the church that is very comfortable with the way things are and fellowship, and it isn't looking for new people. It's not looking for new ideas. It's not looking to grow, and they're not looking for new people to come in and mess this up. But this can also be the church that has nothing going on. There's no ministry. You know, if you buy a field and never use it, the ground, well, what? It'll become compacted. It'll become hard and unable to accept new seed. When a farmer plants a field, they didn't go out and just throw it on top of the hard ground, but they plow the soil, and then they run a harrow over the soil to break it up, and they create a nice loam. And then, once the soil is loose, then they plant the seed. But if he just throws the seed on the hard ground, it will not be able to set down its roots, and birds can come in and snatch it up, or it'll just spoil, kind of rot. Some churches are like that. The soil is hard and compacted from never being used. There's no ministries going on. So when someone new comes in and sets down and tries to find a place where they can let their roots grow, there's just nothing there. And they get snatched away by other activities. And that new faith, it spoils, it rots. Now, the last kind of soil Jesus spoke of is the good soil. This is the deep, the rich, loamy soil that is full of nutrients. This is the church that has many opportunities to become involved. It's a church whose soil is used, and it's always being worked and plowed and harrowed. And the soil is deep and rich. And when someone new comes in, they settle in, and the seed is protected by hospitality and friendship. And it takes on this seed, this hospitality, and it nurtures it and it mentors it until it's ready. And I say until it's ready to send out its roots and find this nice loose soil where it can become strong. But good soil is more than just loose soil, but it's also soil that is rich in nutrients. And a church soil is enriched by providing educational purposes, Christian educational opportunities, youth fellowship, children's ministries, Bible studies, small groups, mission trips, and disciple courses. It's a church where there's joy and fellowship, and it's not just on Sunday morning, but throughout the week. You can come into that church anytime and find someone to sit with. It's a place to, you know, where you can experience the Holy Spirit and vital worship. It's a place that has prayer teams praying for its people and its ministries and its community. It's a place where people care about not just one another, but even strangers. And all of these things help new people to come into a church and to produce fruit, abundant fruit, fruit that will further the kingdom of God. Now, ideally, the church should be this last type of soil, rich, deep, loamy, full of nutrients. But in reality, probably every church has an area that has a little bit of all the soils. But you want to have this one dominant type of soil, the good soil. And so the question for us this morning is our church's dominant soil good soil? Is it filled with weeds that quickly ensnare and strangle new people and chase them out? Is it rocky and shallow, offering just enough to get them interested and in the door and excited, but it doesn't offer anything deeper or lasting that they can set roots into? Is our soil hard and compacted from a lack of use and complacency so that when new people come in, they can't find anywhere to put down roots? Or is our soil good, deep, rich, loamy, full of nutrients, of spiritual disciplines and hospitality, so that when new people come in and visit, they set down and their roots begin to grow and they become productive and fruitful? And one of the ways that you can test this notion, what kind of soil do we have, is by looking and observing, is our garden growing? Or is it getting smaller? Do we have a diversity of people and ministries and things happening, different flowers and fruit blooming? Or is it just one type? The church soil should be the rich, loamy soil. And if it's not, then we need to weed out the weeds. We need to stop doing the things that choke those things out. If we find rocks that are hindering someone, they're a barrier to someone or a stumbling block, then we need to dig those rocks up. And we either need to crush them down so they become part of the soil, or we need to remove them. If our soil is hard and compacted because we're just not doing anything, or if there's an area where it's becoming like that, we need to get busy. We need to get out there with the hoe and the shovel and start turning that soil over. We need to start breaking it down so it can become useful again. You see, each person here needs to receive the gospel message. Our hearts need to be in the proper soil type that can receive it. But then as you are added to this garden, your soil, the soil of your heart, then it affects the soil of the garden. And so we begin with ourselves. What is the soil of my heart like? And that translates into, what is the soil of our church like? I believe here at First Church, we have pretty good soil. But I think there are areas for improvement as well. And so we pray to God to help make us better. Amen? Will you pray with me? Lord, we thank you for this day. And again, hearing this parable we've known for a long time. And yes, We must apply it to ourselves as individuals in our hearts. But Lord, help us to look at our church, always evaluating our soil, always testing the soil. How full are the nutrients? And do we have any weeds coming up that need pulled? Do we have any rocks that need to be removed? Lord, is there any area in our soil that's becoming compacted because it's not being used or it's just always the way it is? Lord, if that is true anywhere, we pray that you would help us to discern that and take the steps necessary to loosen this soil up, to make it a place where anybody can come in and put down roots and become, blossom into the person that you have created them to be. Lord, help us to be this kind of church, this kind of soil, this kind of people. Amen. The Word of God is, that is the seed that we are to spread. And it is wonderful. And we do that by going out and telling others about God. So would you please stand and join me as we sing our closing hymn, The Wonderful Words of Life. Friends, Jesus gives us the beautiful words, the wonderful words of life to take out and scatter among our neighbors and our community. So take the word and go and scatter it. Go scatter the wonderful words and then invite them into our garden. Invite them to come and sit with us and see if their roots don't take root here. Amen?
Amen.
My friends, go in peace. Spreading the word of God and loving one another.